Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jay Kaplan.
And I'm Julia Yrani, and we're from Synack.
Today, we're going to give you a glimpse into the state of our critical infrastructure from a cybersecurity perspective. We're only scratched the surface because there's obviously a ton of information out there, but we're going to do our best to describe this simply and give you a little bit of humor along the way.
Yeah, you know, it's common knowledge that the state of our nation's infrastructure, cybersecurity, is pretty bad. But we're going to try and tell you how and why it's bad. And we're going to do that by taking you through a couple of examples, one that has happened and one that could hypothetically happen as soon as tomorrow. But before we get into all of those gory details, I want to take a minute and think about your morning and how many times you have already depended on critical infrastructure to work seamlessly for you. You woke up, you stumbled to the bathroom, you flipped a light switch on. And a light turned on. There's one. Then you got into the shower, you turned the shower knob on, and hot water came out. There's two. And then you got yourself dressed, and you got in the car, maybe you jumped on the subway, and you got yourself to work. There's three.
Those are all examples of what we mean when we say critical infrastructure, but let us define it for you a little bit more simply. I mean, at least it's more simple to me. When I think of infrastructure, I think of anything that can be destroyed, compromised, or battled over in an action movie. Think power grids, water utilities, energy supply plants, and so forth.
Or as John Oliver would add, anything that can be saved by Bruce Willis in an action movie.
We all know how critical this infrastructure is in our everyday lives.
And based on our reliance on it working properly for us, we would think that our policymakers would pour time and money figuring out creative ways to protect it better from a cybersecurity perspective. But the truth is that they don't. And it's really confounding, and it begs the question of why. But since they love to talk so much, we thought we'd let them talk for themselves.
As you know, infrastructure is not a sexy or glamorous topic.
As much as I like to think otherwise, infrastructure is not sexy.
Infrastructure is not very sexy.
And we all know how important it is for American politicians to keep it sexy.
To be fair, politicians are much more keen on building something new than trying to fix the old. They love the cute ribbon-cutting ceremony. They love to take credit for it when they run for re-election and so forth.
The problem is when we're so focused on the new, we tend to neglect the old. And much of our infrastructure was built over 50 years ago with what is now considered outdated and old systems and little to no cybersecurity consideration because it just wasn't as big of a threat. And over the years, we've tried to retrofit these systems with more technology and connect them to the internet and do things like that, which of course has made them more efficient, but it's also made them infinitely more vulnerable.
Listen, guys, my former life was at the NSA, right? So I have a pretty unique perspective on just how easy we're making it for those that are attacking our energy grids and critical infrastructure organizations, whether it's part of a broader campaign or just probing for information. So as a result of this, coupled with a lot of data that we're about to show you, we're going to give a grade of our nation's critical infrastructure an epic fail.
And we've actually managed to quantify this epic fail. And we did that by working with a third-party research firm whose job it was to go out and gather information around the general sentiment of information security in these infrastructure organizations. And after talking primarily to folks in healthcare, water, energy, and transportation, there were three things that were very obvious. One, confidence was very low. Two, resources were very scarce. And three, preparedness was very limited.
So let's look at some of the headline stats. When we put out this survey, we found that one in five of those that we surveyed are not confident in their ability to detect and respond to an attack. Pretty eye-opening number. On top of that, 73% do not adequately protect their sensitive internal network. And we're going to talk about why that's so important shortly. And, you know, this could all be part of a broader picture that 50% of these organizations don't even have a dedicated security team. So they're pretty ill-equipped and they're not very prepared.
And that's why the U.S. puts itself in the position of being susceptible to potentially paralyzing cyber attacks. Think back to last December, for example, when we learned that Iranian hackers were able to successfully infiltrate the computer systems that control the floodgates at the Rybrook Dam in New York. And it shocked the American people. But we have to think about this for a minute. The average age, again, of dams in the U.S. is 52. And that's why the dams, along with the 57,000 other documented industrial control systems that are connected to the internet and likely poorly protected, are very worrisome targets for our nation.
Even worse, America didn't even know what happened. I mean, there's actually been about a dozen times in the past decade where a bad actor has compromised one of our internal electric utilities or other industrial control systems. And that's even a small number. That's a fraction of the over 295 incidents that DHS reported last year alone, up significantly from the year prior. And the U.S. is not alone. Worldwide infrastructure is just as vulnerable. If you look at the incident last year, in the case of Ukraine, there was a piece of malware called Black Energy that was tracked back to the Russian government. It left approximately 700,000 people in the dark without power. The attackers used a spear phishing campaign to gain access to an internal network, were able to then gain access to their process control systems and ultimately shut off the power grid. They then flooded the phone lines and made it impossible for the local authorities and the government to respond adequately to the attack.
And while assisting with the post-breach investigation, the U.S. government also admitted that they found the same malware variant, Black Energy, on our power grid several times in the last 3 years, which makes me feel a little bit like we're sitting ducks or almost shark bait. But what's important to point out here is that the U.S. power grid systems and our infrastructure in general is much more automated and complex, which means we're a harder nut to crack, we're a harder target, right? But that also means that a successful hack of this target would be much harder to fix.
So let's refocus on the United States for a second. You know, for most things that have catastrophic potential, the U.S. uses regulation for risk mitigation. I'll give you some examples of this. In Portland, Maine, it's actually illegal to tickle a woman under the chin with a feather duster. Did you know that? In Alabama, it's illegal to play dominoes on a Sunday. And in Washington, it's illegal to pretend that one's parents are rich. Obviously, you know, these are all jokes, but it's really funny to see how the U.S. is so focused on things that really don't matter. But, you know, we're taking critical infrastructure, which is so important to our every single day lives, and making it more of an afterthought.
But we do have to acknowledge progress where progress is made. In this case, the electricity sector is the only critical infrastructure sector that has put in place any sort of mandatory and enforceable policy to better their cybersecurity posture. And they did this under the guidance of the North American Energy Reliability Center, which is a nonprofit. And they're really lucky to have access to this sort of resource. And across the rest of the critical infrastructure sectors, there is a cultural shift towards cybersecurity awareness, and we see that materialize in things like the NIST framework that came out last year, as well as a couple of DHS initiatives, but nothing tangible, nothing that's been put on the books and enforceable just yet.
The NERC is on its fifth iteration of its initiative, and it focuses on bringing all bulk electrical systems into scope. And it requires that these electrical utilities comply with these standards and sets a certain timeline. And obviously, we're doing a lot better, right? We're going to get there eventually. But the reality is that this is a pretty minimal level of protection. And it's simply not enough to counteract the onslaught of attacks against IT and critical infrastructure control systems.
I'd also like to point out that the implementation of the prior version 4, was skipped altogether due to some sort of complication. And version 5 is set to go live on April 1st. And I can smell a good April Fool's joke from a mile away.
To put this all into perspective, we wanted to create a fictional attacker for you. We'll start with the country, and we call that country Kyrgyzstan. That's actually not completely fictional. The New York Times made it up last year when there was a typo in the newspaper. We created this cyber profile, which is pretty analogous to what we're seeing out there today. You know, a great, sophisticated army of cyber hackers, a stockpile of zero-day exploits, and homegrown custom malware and implants.
And although we desperately hope for a good fight, this is what the data tells us that the KLA and its counterparts are up against. Over 50% of respondents told us they don't have a single dedicated resource for cybersecurity, which means the responsibility of cybersecurity falls under the larger IT organization, or in some cases, even under the physical security organization, both of whom are grossly underqualified for this sort of work. And when you compare that to the large percentage of Fortune 500 companies who have a well-funded and well-built-out cybersecurity organization, you see who's prioritizing security and who's not. But if you take a step back, even the Fortune 500 companies are depending on the country to keep the lights on. And it gets even better. About 10% of our respondents told us that they have one dedicated security resource. Which gets kind of messy, right, when you're depending on one person to define and implement and monitor all of your cybersecurity strategy and policy. I mean, look at Hillary Clinton. She took her security strategy and definition and implementation into her own hands, and look where she ended up.
Now, we talked a little bit about the KLA, so now let's talk about the target that they're actually going to be going after. We've created here a pretty typical energy utility company on the East Coast, and they're not typical just from a demographic standpoint, but also given their network topography. One of the really interesting stats that we found was that 60% of the organizations that we surveyed have a direct connectivity path from their internal corporate environment to their process control systems. Why is this scary? Well, the process control systems are the things that regulate the chemical balance in water. They're the things that send energy into all of our homes and so forth. So they're really, really important. If we have a segue or a path from the corporate environment to these PCSs, it means that we can theoretically compromise the integrity of the corporate network, maybe through a phishing campaign like the case of Ukraine, swim onto the PCS, and then game over from there. Even scarier, though, 92% of those that we surveyed have outside-in connectivity. It means you can access the process control system from the internet directly. That means you can exploit right from the internet to the PCS and game over again. And even further, a similar statistic holds true for inside-out connectivity, meaning beaconing implants and other mechanisms where you need to get out of the network are very, very simple. We're making it too easy. The KLA that we mentioned before, they're going to have a pretty easy time when you have a network topography as connected as this. Segmentation is obviously a huge problem.
So what happens next in this story? The KLA has the foothold they need, and it was pretty easy to get there. Something moves them in the geopolitical arena, and they decide to attack. Lights out. I want to go back for 1 minute to the Ukrainian example to talk about their response plan, because it's interesting. When they realized that the computer systems that were controlling the grid were infected and therefore couldn't be used to get the grid restarted, they decided to completely power them off and instead leaned on their manual protocol, which in their case was literally as simple as deploying a group of people throughout the country to go flip light switches on to start generators. And the sad reality is that the Ukrainian people are used to things like this. They're used to prolonged power outages and all of the unpleasantness that comes with it. But if you think about the US and the uproar that would happen or take place if let's say the KLA was able to take down the Eastern Seaboard power grid. 15 states go dark, including Washington, D.C. The stock market freezes, we lose billions of dollars, mortality rates in hospitals spike, and my friends in New York can't charge their cell phones, and it's all very tragic. No, but seriously, we don't have to look very far back into our past to see an example of the dire toll a power outage can take on an American community. I'm thinking along the lines of the aftermath of Hurricane Sandy.
So with manual intervention necessary, someone obviously needs to be on site to stop it, making an attack with an extended duration very probable. In an event like where KLA attacked the energy utility, we would have to have local responders such as DHS, FBI, the industry ISACs, all part of the picture to contain the incident and respond to it adequately. The problem is that by cobbling together a response plan with all of these different agencies, and when we're talking about widespread impacts, either just across the Eastern Seaboard or across the nation as a whole, we're going to have a really hard time restarting that power grid and getting things up and running.
But at least we're starting to talk about it, right? There was a recent panel on Capitol Hill that was designed around this very topic, right, about how we would respond as a nation to some sort of attack on our infrastructure. And the panelists made mention of a cyber national mission force that would be constructed to deal with it. But when probed for details about who they are, how they would engage, and when they would engage, there's pretty much no detail. And when someone asked from the audience, hey, which agency would be heading this up? The response was, it's a work in progress. And all of us here today know what it means when we tell our boss that the project is still very much a work in progress. And in terms of painting a better picture for tomorrow, that's not necessarily what the data does for us. Over 60% of respondents told us that they don't have adequate budget, they don't have adequate training, and they don't have system updates in place in the near term, meaning the next 6 months, to set the foundation to really make strides forward in their cybersecurity posture in the next 1 to 2 years.
So this is really a pretty mismatch fight. I mean, nearly half of our respondents agree that their process control networks are vulnerable to cyber threats. Due to gaps in network security, and their weak and outdated systems are not getting any stronger. And then you couple that with the fact that now 75% are actually allocating little to no budget on security initiatives in 2016. There's obviously a mismatch there. It doesn't make sense. If there are so many problems, we need to be spending more money into fixing these problems and to stopping the attackers. Really, how crazy would it be if a nation as powerful as ours was brought to its knees because we didn't put the necessary money in place and the strategy in place to detect and stop these attacks?
And here we take a cue from Ted Koppel, who is asking the American people to pause for a second and to consider the internet as a potential weapon of mass destruction, which at first seems a bit hysterical. It seems a bit dramatic. But knowing that what we know now about the state of our critical infrastructure and security, he actually has a point.
It's a threat unlike any other America has ever faced. We have plans for other weapons of mass destruction.
We also have plans in place for natural disasters.
An attack like this would touch more than either of these events combined, but we don't have an extensive response plan.
And for now, our enemies will likely stay quiet and stealthy in our networks while we fumble on the other end of the fight, trying to construct some sort of meaningful and enforceable regulation to better our security. But that really gives the enemy all the control, right? Because when they want to strike, they're already in place.
We're not just flirting with disaster, we're asking for it. So pay attention, stay informed, and if you're part of one of these organizations, be proactive and get to know your attack surface better. Thank you.
Thank you.